Hi, welcome to a very special Zoom reunion with the cast of one of the Quantapow players' most beloved shows, Becky's New Car. I'm your host, Margaret McCarty, and for the next hour, we're going to reminisce, tell stories, read a scene or two, and relive a special show.
Oh, hi.
Miss Barbara, how are you?
I'm doing very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm a little weary, long day, but you know, I'm excited.
Long 6 months.
Well, that too, sure.
What's going on?
Well, we're doing this Zoom thing to reunionize all of you people. Is that a word?
It is now.
Yeah, I just made it so. And you got to be Becky.
I did.
And that was pretty cool.
Did
you have a moment when you were reading the script and you said, I want to do that?
From the opening page, I think, from reading it.
Okay.
I had the chance to do anything like that. And just reading, just even the stage directions at the very beginning and trying to even imagine how you would do that, talking to the audience without anybody there and breaking that fourth wall. And from the very, very beginning, I wanted to do it.
Oh, excellent. And how was the auditioning? Was it nerve-wracking, or did you feel like, I have got this?
No, never felt like I've got this. As a matter of fact, I think when Mark called me, I was convinced that he was going to ask me if I could paint the set or something wonderful, which I would have been happy to do. Never in a million years thought I got it. Absolutely not. No.
Oh my gosh, you were so good in that part.
Thank you.
So that whole, fetching and carrying and making people in the audience fetch and carry, do you have one really good moment that you can tell us about? Because that always struck me as a really fun part to make people do your bidding.
Actually, what was interesting every single night was saying my lines, and as I'm doing it, I'm trying to figure out who's going to play and who's not going to play. You could almost see as I'm walking towards them that they're don't make me do it. The hardest was trying to get people to come up on stage to help with the dressing part. That was the hardest. And then there were people that really wanted to do it and you didn't really want them to do it. But for the most part, it was just such an interesting thing. And you just never knew that change every night, that changed the show so much. Some audiences really wanted to play and other audiences just wanted to listen and they did not want to be involved at all. So that was challenging. If this answers the question, my favorite moment was, I know this so specifically, was Sean's mother, Judy. I got her up on stage to help me dress, and the necklaces were all tangled up, and she's swearing, and I'm like, Judy! And I think Jason Myatt's kids were in the audience that day, so I'm like, Judy, there are kids! I'm not kidding, there's kids here, so let's PG it up a little bit, okay? She was fabulous, she was so wonderful. I want to just hand the show off to her.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, I think probably the best thing though about that part is that you have this very lighthearted ad lib part and then it gets so deep at the end. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really requires a lot. You have to have the impeccable comic timing that you have.
Well, thank you.
But then also, I mean, those pictures that Mark was just showing were that I just love that one where you're just holding the steering wheel, looking so sad, and it's just a beautiful moment.
Well, I always said the same thing. Because of Chris Cardoni and David Berti, I was able to get to that place because they made it such a hard decision, I could almost feel the audience going with me every step of the way and almost thinking to themselves, I don't know what I'd do. I don't know who I would choose. I don't know what I would, exactly. And I always laughed because I'm like, please, there would be a line out the door of women with casseroles for Chris Cardoni in 2 seconds. So I'm not worried. But they really made it so that they allowed me to fall in love with both of them each night so that it really became a journey every single night.
Something else I should talk about, except that I am so tired. I need more caffeine.
Oh, can I get you a Diet Coke? Would you like that?
Oh my gosh, that would be so fabulous, except I did this wrong.
Oh, would you like a Diet Coke by any chance?
Why, yes, I would. Oh, thank you. That was so awkward. But you know what? Maybe the caffeine will kick in and it'll be great.
So I can just keep handing you soda if you'd like.
Yeah, that would be wonderful. I would like that a great deal.
I say this all the time, it was one of the hardest experiences and one of my absolute favorite experiences by far. It was just the whole cast together was just, and Mark and the whole production crew, everything involved in it was just seamless and everybody was working towards the same goal the entire time. So it was really amazing.
Well, I gotta say, I can't imagine anybody else playing that part because I just feel like it was made for you.
I'll do it
clearly.
Again.
Yeah. I'll keep doing it. So I think we should introduce to the conversation Chris Cardoni. Show your saint of a husband. And there he is.
Just the line in Winter Reunion.
Yeah.
I have my sword over here. But we're doing the Becky thing. Sorry.
Yeah, you've done so many. It's hard to keep them straight.
Yeah. Hi. How you doing?
Hi.
Yes, I play the saint.
What brought you into playing a saint? What appealed to you about playing a saint?
Well, so here's the story. I auditioned for this show, as I so often do, because Melissa wanted to audition for the show. So I went also. And I was interested in any other part. The part that I wanted was Jason's part. I wanted Steve. I liked that funny monologue that he had. And then I said, well, if I don't get that, I'd go for the guy, the rich guy. And so I ended up with Joe. I think that, I have a tendency to think of myself as an actor, and I gravitate towards parts like Cyrano de Bergerac or Sherlock Holmes and things like that. But Mr. Baumhardt has a way of seeing other things, as good directors do. They'll look at an actor and say, I see this thing. And so even though I didn't really feel like I could play a regular guy like this, somehow he saw that I could. And when I read it, I kind of thought, this guy is a sack. What is this guy, why does he put up with this stuff? It's ridiculous. But when you start to get into the journey and get other stuff out of the way and really start to connect with what that person is feeling like in the moment, then, it made sense. So if you think about it, it's a little bit of a, his wife pretends to be dead so she can be with another man, but in the end, he's able to somehow embrace that. So, it was an interesting journey. And so in a way, it was kind of getting me out of my own way so that I could connect with this guy, Joe. And I think.
You did it so beautifully.
Yeah. And Mark does a good job at not only pushing you to do that, but letting you do it. So, it had some great moments. As Barbara said earlier, there are just some moments where you feel like this is as good as you can have it be. There were a lot of scenes like that throughout the show with Barbara and others. There was that scene with David at the end where I finally confront him and, he says, are you going to kill me? And I'm like, no yet. Just the look on his face, so to be able to play off of that, to get, it's a cliche, but it's like a great tennis match,
Because I had the same feeling playing off of you too, because you have that brilliant, dry sense of humor, and you can just deliver the funniest line in the world. I'm chewing the inside of my mouth because I don't want to laugh on stage. Every night when you're like, oh, it's been a really good day. Let's not ruin it by having a talk, but you're so dry about it.
Right, so
brilliantly. I think I joked about bringing my knitting on stage to wait while the audience is laughing and laughing, laughing. I'm like, I might as well work on my knitting for a while.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. He's got this very quiet way of saying things. It's not, it's not a big declamatory part,
no.
but there's so much strength in it from those simple things that he says like that.
No, he's cooking under the surface.
Right, exactly. So, yeah.
Excellent. And that, would you say that that scene with David, that confrontation scene, was that what you looked forward to the most? Was that your favorite?
It was a great moment. I mean, that little game that we play where we switch cell phones, and you know we're both going to call her but pretend to be the other one, and it's such a such an asshole thing to do, but he does it, you know. Things were leading to that. I think that was one of the top scenes, but then also the scene, another big scene for me was the after the funeral when Becky comes back.
Oh, love that scene.
And you know, that moment of looking at that. I mean, the moment was so fraught. Because I always felt, and you, Barb, I'm sure you feel this too, when you know that you have the audience and they're in the story and they're in the moment, and it always felt like that at that moment. It was like, because they've been seeing all the stuff that's happening, there's a lot of goofy stuff, and that's one of the things, as you said earlier about the show, it starts off sort of goofy and then goes to this really deep place, and that was the culmination of it, like what's going to happen between these people at this moment. And
a really great line in that, when you really shut me down finally, where something like, you don't get to put a period on your life. There's some line that
you don't get to do that. Yeah. You just got to live with it for a while. Yeah.
And you got to wonder, you know, how many people in the audience were not betting on you, but maybe betting on the other man.
Well, and also, you know, was I going to stay, and was I going to put up with it? Wasn't going to be a simple choice for her between
these guys. Why do you think you did stay?
Really loved her. Mm-hmm. And I think that in some way he understood what she was looking for and why she needed to do what she did. And why it was important for her to do that. You know, it's not something that she could have learned in any other way.
Right.
You know, the ending, if you remember, the very last scene, it's not entirely like, oh, everything's going to be great between these two people. There's a little ambiguity there, because that's how life is.
At this point, we maybe should bring in the other man, the lovely and talented David Berti, because you kiss, right?
Walter Flood.
He is a handsome man. I have to give him that.
Look at, seriously, it wasn't fair. How could I choose between the two of you?
No. I'm wondering, they've been sharing their favorite moments. How about your favorite moment?
I have two. The scene with Becky on Walter's deck, where we have our big passionate kiss. I loved that scene. And the scene at the end that we talked about with Chris, that was just a really wacky, but it, like Chris said, there was stuff underneath it, but some of it was just so crazy. I think I had a line where he says, do you want a drink? And I say, and he gives me wine. And I say, you have something stronger, like a gun. the script is just so well written. It's so funny and so, but it really has a lot going for it. So those two scenes definitely stand out for me as scenes that I just love doing. I mean, the whole play was just wonderful. Everybody was great.
I'm wondering if we should bring in the slightly damaged co-worker of Becky, which is Steve, who was played by Jason Myatt. If he will come in now, that would be lovely.
Oh, hey, what are you guys doing here? What the?
You just happened to be in Zoom and look.
Yeah, exactly, stumbled in here.
I still don't remember you being in the show. Who were you?
No, I was. I was. Remember it? That it was kind of like a cocktail party, and you were out on the patio, up in your fancy balcony there. and I was one of the servers that would pass by. I didn't have any lines, but I would pass by the door back and forth carrying drinks for people. Mark told me about this script, as you know, as Barbara mentioned, you know, earlier before the auditions, and I like read it. I think I kind of skimmed it. I was like, yeah, all right, whatever. And then I saw him again. And he said, "Hey, so that script?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "No, no, take a look at that part." And he really, like Chris was saying, like the guy knows, what he's talking about. So I said, "All right, well, maybe I should give it another look." And then, like somehow, reading the character, it just like jumped off the screen to off the page to me. And the show we had done before was All My Sons, not exactly a light, fun comedy, nor a character that was fun and weird and kind of damaged in a comic way like Steve. So I was really, I think it's really a testament to Mark's kind of eye. So I said, "Oh, wow, yeah, I'm glad you kind of pointed me in the direction of that." So coming in, I was happy that he kind of nudged me, and I was in love with the character from the time of reading it that second time through the run. So, yeah.
And do you have a moment that just stands out in your memory after all this time that says, "Oh, this was so much fun"?
An earlier scene in the car dealership, Becky's trying to do her job and go about her day, and Steve comes in like on his break and just wants someone to vent to, and it's so self-indulgent how he just kind of takes over her little workspace and talks about a sale that he just had with this woman and like gets into this mesmerized kind of thing about seeing his reflection in her like super perfectly dark polished nails and seeing his face in her nails, and he gets kind of carried away, and at one point he's like, "Hey, are you listening to me?" And she's like, "Oh yeah, yeah." And so it was a really funny scene with Barbara because she's so such a great, generous listener as an actor on stage. And so to be in this really indulgent kind of way with this character who just kind of wants to have all the attention on himself and all the pity, that scene where he just kind of really, goes all out with his indulgence to play off Barbara for that was just really, really fun.
Yeah, I gotta say that, what I remember most is that, oh, it's so funny. But then I think about your individual characters and I think, wow, they were all so sad in their own way.
Yeah.
There are so many wonderful flaws, like real people.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think that's some of the brilliance of the script is bringing these people in and having their kind of sadness and their particular conflicts become this like really comedic explosion of human relationships, and then as you mentioned, it goes to a much kind of deeper, heavier place later on. So I think it's really brilliant script.
I think it's about time to bring the somewhat happy couple. I'd like to welcome Michael Carr, who played Chris Foster, and Laura Liberge, who played Kenny Flood. And there they are.
Hey.
Hey. My little boy's all grown up.
Yeah, he's got a gray beard like mine. It's so cute.
Oh, Dad. You're always so sweet to me.
So, Michael, what brought you to this play?
I don't know. I think Mark emailed me, said someone recommended me to audition. I didn't even know about it. And they hadn't found somebody or something, or maybe they had somebody and they quit or something. And then, so they contacted me.
That never happened.
And then, so I just came in and read like way after the audition process. I think that's it, right?
Well, probably because you are a young man, so it's hard to find young men who are going to audition. So I can see that.
And when I shave, I lose about 15 years. So it's good.
And Laura, so when you read it, were you excited to audition?
Yes, and it's funny because I just came back to the States. I just finished my master's degree and I pretty much had a fire lit underneath me to start auditioning just across the board. So went to good old Theater 411 and just started applying and started auditioning slots. And this one was the first one up, oddly enough. And I've never done a production at QP before. This is my first, and gratitude that this was my first production with such a wonderful cast and crew, and the script was amazing. So starting going through the process of the audition, this wonderful like energy to the script to it, it just made me so excited. And it really like pushed me through, and I'm thankful that I got in. I was like, oh, this is nice. You know, just out of school and I get something. I was just very blessed, but very blessed.
I'll go with Michael first. Did you have a favorite moment, a favorite scene?
My favorite was Jason Myatt's puppy story. I know it was because I always had an opportunity to go watch it in rehearsal, and literally every rehearsal I would go watch it, and every time it'd be like new and fresh and it'd be something new, and it was like an educational experience. But like, I think one of my favorites to do was with Barbara, probably our first one, where she's basically trying to psychoanalyze me and tell me like, what's wrong with you? You can't like, you're not like your other people your age. And then by the end, I'm like, oh, so actually, so tell me, what is it, you know, so then I'm basically like her therapist by the end of it, you know, and that was really fun. So, yeah.
Oh,
they're all great.
Yeah. And Laura, what about you? What was your favorite moment either that you were involved in or you were watching?
So, two, I'm going to ride on the back of that puppy monologue. That was just every night I was crying, laughing. But also, I'm thinking back to the scene between Michael and I, where I come bolting into the room in workout gear. That's with the picture where you had the shirtless, let's say.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm carrying this crutch because my character pretends to have some kind of ankle injury to prevent me from running, because I secretly hate running, but I kind of wanted to convince your character I liked running because I really liked you, and it was that kind of like beautiful.
That's right. Also,
you're such a quirky, I guess, kind of like moment for both of us too, yeah. For our characters as well. It gave a lot of depth to both, you know, yeah. Writing wise. So, yeah.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun little scenes where we just kind of come in with a ton of energy.
Right, just like.
And then we're out, you know. So that was actually fun, you know. Just, all right, I gotta get myself ready for this one thing. Like, I'm gonna tell Dad I'm proposing, right? I gotta end this. I gotta come up from studying. It's always like this huge energy coming in. And, yeah.
Prep backstage was quite fun too, to start those off. Just yeah. Gonna get right in there, you know. So,
so what do we think? Did you guys stay together? Do you think they split up after they found out about who they were related to and the relationship with each other? I mean, do you think they were really a happy couple?
I believe, yes, they did. There was definitely a break in, you know, towards the end to kind of sort some things out because it really, because it was a chaotic bundle of a mess. But a standpoint of Kenny, this was, I think, her first real kind of love connection that she felt true about. During the script, she talks about her boyfriend of the time, who was like, you know, of her class, very rich, and, you know, goes sailing around the world, but to the point where they never see each other. And then she meets Mike's character, and it's, you know, it felt real. It's the first real relationship. So I don't think she would throw that away too soon.
Well, I think after hearing that and how interested I was in her, that if she had any kind of, showed me any kind of potential to get back together, I would have jumped at it. Yeah.
We had such good role models for relationships.
Right.
All right. Well, last but certainly not least, let's bring in our scorned lady friend, Ginger. I love that name. It's so Gilligan's Island. Nice. Demetra, there she is. Oh my goodness.
Martin.
All right, so how did you get roped into this? When you read it, did you think, oh my gosh, I have to be part of this?
I love the play, but I wanted to play Barbara's part, of course. Everyone did. But well, except Jason.
I wouldn't put it past him.
Yeah, yeah. I might need, anyway.
And I didn't know anyone from this. So I didn't know Mark. I didn't know anyone in the cast. So when I was offered Ginger, I was like, who's playing, you know? And I didn't know Barbara, but I was like, okay, yes, I'll do it. And I'm really, really glad I did, because it was great. And I loved it.
Oh, good.
And I love the play. I mean, it's a great play.
So I'm going to ask that same question. Favorite moment, either or both, when you were on stage or when you were watching?
Okay, so I don't have a favorite moment. I have a really bad memory, and it was a long time ago, but I also played Mrs. Tipton, who just showed up behind a scrim. Hi. And I almost was late one time, and I still, do you remember that? And I was mortified, and I like had to run, and I still crack up thinking, what the was I doing? How could I possibly be late? And I loved the music for that little bit, so that was always fun. And then I loved drinking my little martini up on the balcony with David, and then telling him that his first wife was a cookie sheet. It was a really fun part. And Ginger was excellent. She was scrappy, and she fell in love with the right guy at the end.
I suppose we have to bring in the guy that you keep mentioning, the director.
They don't need that. No. Oh, there he is! Oh!
He's here anyway. Sorry.
Oh, man, there he is.
Now it's a clean Brady Bunch. Woo!
And I feel like I shouldn't ask you any questions, because I know you'll just talk. So go ahead.
It's so awesome to see everybody in my little windows here. Oh my God, so good. Love at first sight on the script. And at the time, you know, the challenge is when you're a director and you like are just so head over heels over a script, is the process for a lot of theaters is it's, oh, you got to get to play reading and is it going to get picked? But Hovey in Waltham, you just go pitch it. So I was like, okay, I want to do this really badly. So I'm going to go to Waltham and I'm going to go to Hovey, and I'd worked there before. I'm going to pitch this. And they picked it and didn't get the rights. So sadness. So I ended up doing November by David Mamet instead, a play that Jason Myatt was in at QP. Mm-hmm. But I did it with Gordon Ellis and Ann Damon and Bill Stambaugh and Nick Bennett Zenzian. And fast forward, all of a sudden it's on QP's list. And I remember feeling guilty, because I was like, I didn't do that, because I didn't want, you know, because Hovey was like, oh, if you would still want to come back and do Becky's New Car at some point. But now that it was on QP's list, I'm like, I really would rather do it at QP for a number of reasons. So I had to play that politics game where you write the email to friends involved with Hovey and say, I swear to God, this wasn't, but I have to do it at QP, you understand, right? So the rest is history. And
you know, some of those people are going to be watching this, maybe.
Yep.
Man.
You can't do it because you can't have that big poster. That big poster. Our poster would not work on the Hovey stage.
To get the talent I got, oh my God. And I, you know, I especially loved, you know, Chris was talking about, you know, his vision of what character he wanted to play, but kind of where it ended up landing. And he's right, because that character was on the page, could come across as just kind of a wet sap blanket. He gets pushed over. And that, again, that's why theater isn't puppets. It's why it's artists who you let play and discover, and oh my God, and what, you know, the strength and power that he brought to that role. I can't even, I mean, that's just an example of what's good theater's all about, right? You have a certain thing in your head
Then, you're embarrassing him.
Sorry, but you know, and then
keep going.
Good actors take it to that, and that's true with everybody in this, in these little boxes, without a doubt, right? Is, you know, and then when I went and read it again this week, preparing for this, you're all in my head when I read it. Like, seriously, like every choice. Like, and again, you know, a lot of times you do a play, you didn't quite get the choice you wanted, and we kind of, it kind of bothers us even years later. We go, yeah, this moment never really worked the way I wanted to. But with this one, I'm reading it, and it's all of your voices, 100%, and I can't imagine it any other way. And every choice is perfect. It's true.
Okay, we're out then.
What's the next play? This is making me really miss theater.
Oh.
No.
This is making me happy and so sad all at the same time.
So Mark,
is there another question I should be asking?
Well, no, Chris has a question.
I was just going to say, what is it that draws you to quirky, odd, not quite right characters like these? Because you are drawn to characters like that.
Yeah. I mean, I think Margaret kind of nailed it earlier when she talked about that there's, you know, it's funny, it's well-written, it's snappy, which, you know, is exciting because the audience is going to enjoy that. But then it has such a heart and it gets so serious. And it's so truthful. And you were so right about the ending. Again, like it was yesterday, I can see the last moments of this play because it meant that much to me. And it was that powerful because it had, go ahead, Barbara. Yeah.
I was gonna say, I can hear the music coming on.
Oh,
the
bear. Right. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
I love the script, but you can choose to do it just flat out comedy. I think because you directed it, you made a lot of choices that you were willing to sacrifice some of the obvious laugh lines for this, what I always say, the soft white underbelly of these characters, to show the cracks in the surface, which drew the audience in so much more, showing vulnerability. It wasn't just a page by page comedy, which you could do it that way. It was because you made a lot of choices along the way and we worked on a lot of different things to make it heartfelt and to make these characters real damaged, or, you know, real people, really.
Right.
Yeah. I remember Mark saying a couple times, I don't know the specific instance, but he used the word earnest and like, and that, like, if you don't have that in every character, that it just doesn't really work. So the comedy doesn't work. The serious stuff doesn't work.
Right.
There's something that everybody can attach to every one of the characters. So.
Yeah, without a doubt. And I love the ambiguity of it, right? It's like, they're going to try to make it work, but it's not rosy and perfect. Life isn't rosy and perfect. So good. The other story I want to tell, not to heap more praise on Chris, and I'll get to the rest of you, but
oh my God.
I know.
Why not?
You guys later.
I know. But it's a fun theater story, right? Because again, I love the script obviously, but the one thing I didn't like when I read it was that Joe all of a sudden talks to the audience. I was like, that's Becky's thing.
Oh,
like,
great.
Becky owns this space. What is Stephen Dietz doing having Joe all of a sudden talk to the audience late in Act Two? And I just didn't think it was a good choice from a writing standpoint. And I wasn't 100% sure that it worked until, if you remember, we were in the same footprint as Les Mis Extravaganza at Concord Players. And Tuesday dress rehearsal, we had 14 people in the audience for that. It was like a performance because there were so many, and they're all theater people. And so that, talk about scary, right? It's only Tuesday and, you know, we're going to get real reaction here. And I'll never forget, Chris, when you broke that moment and you did that, you know, yeah, ask this guy. And it was like, I still get the chills just thinking about it because it was just perfect. And the audience, those 14 people that were theater people, could not stop laughing. Because it was so jarring and so real, and they weren't expecting it, and it was wonderful.
It's great, and then he says to her, "What, you didn't? You think I couldn't see these people?"
Yeah,
and then you leave, and you leave me on stage alone with them. I'm like,
I always saw that as he always understood Becky so much, but he didn't. He let her breathe,
yep.
You know, and that's why it worked. And even then, he like. I know you're talking to these people. You know, it's just kind of that.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, and it was hers until now, until he needed to show her that he knew about it.
Yeah, it's almost like I get you. See? Yeah.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah, and then of course, you know, what Barbara went through with the audience stuff, right? You just don't know. I mean, just the scary prospect of who's going to play, who's really into this, and having the, but that was fun too. And I think ultimately, I hope you in performance enjoyed that some nights they stapled and some nights they didn't, right?
That's right. Yeah. The one night when someone did, they did all of them. And that was there was only one night where they stapled all of them. And when Chris comes in and he's like, you brought work home? And I was like, I haven't rehearsed this. It's all done. It's all done. Ad lib.
Yeah, so for me, I mean, obviously, you know, for Demetra, the cookie sheet moment is just, I mean, in a writing standpoint, that was also a challenge for me on the page because it kind of comes out of nowhere. But again, another example of an actress just taking it and making it work, you know, totally. And just finding that build up in that moment to make that snap that just was so truthful. So
that was a great scene.
Yes. So truthful. So that totally worked. And again, on the page, you're like, I'm not sure. And then of course the whole conceit where Kenny and everybody meets each other, again, could have easily been sticky and, you know, slapsticky. I mean, and you know, but it just, we built this foundation of truth. It was just so fun and we never pushed it. It was just like, wait a minute. It was great.
Not all of
them. Okay.
All
right.
So what I would love to see now that I'm running the show, Margaret, sorry. Sure. All right, so we've talked about it a lot since I haven't gotten to Jason yet. Jason, do you have your script?
Yes, I do. Is it better, the online one or this one? Does it matter?
It doesn't matter, whatever you're comfortable with. All right, start it with, hi, mister, you look sad. Do you want to pet my puppy?
Okay.
Mark, never say that line again. Never.
No one should ever say that line again.
Hi, mister, you look sad. Do you want to pet my puppy? And what I thought, what I didn't say, even though I wanted to, what I thought was, you bet I do, sonny boy. I want to pet your little puppy. And then I want to take a walk with him and you, a nice walk, a nice little hike in the mountains with you right by his side. And as we approach the rugged vista, which is our destination, I want to let go of his leash for just a second, just an instant, right when the path beneath his little paws starts to give way. And I want you to watch your little puppy's desperate eyes as he tries to grab at that ground, but his little paws, they touch nothing at all. Nothing but air, nothing but air and nothing but you and your screams, and you might as well scream your heart out, sonny boy, because there is nothing you can do for that puppy of yours who is falling down, down, down into a dark abyss that will never ever give him back.
At least you only thought it.
I only thought I thought it. Turns out I said it. It was ugly. I mean, the kid cried till he threw up. His mom dumped a frappuccino on me.
The other thing I loved about that was, I remember you were right at the edge of your light, remember? Because, you know, Jason Banal was our lighting designer, and I'm like, how much room, you know, it's like, because we can only write, and you just go right to the edge.
and I like the part that we worked out, it was your idea, I think, about the, about like really watching him, the puppy go all the way down. That's great.
Right.
Oh my God.
So good.
Man.
Well, the other scene, the other scene that I just was thinking of was one of my favorites was, of course, as talked about before, the Walter Joe scene with the whole, just that awkwardness of it was just Oh, you know, just we didn't know who was going to do what, and just, you know, oh, so good.
And it comes at the right time in the story, in that the audience has really gotten to know each character so much and the whole situation. And then they're finally in our living room together, and you can just feel the whole audience, like, not even breathing, just like waiting to see what's going to happen.
So now I should jump in with something like, okay, so you remember that scene where you guys switched phones? Do you remember that? That was awesome.
Switching phones, and we each had the other one's phone.
Did you ever pick them up?
switch phones. Yeah,
which, was there anything really crazy that happened during any one of these shows that went wrong, like any technical thing? Or I don't remember there ever, I mean, it's rife for it, but I don't really remember any, like sometimes in shows you have just these, a wall falls over or something. I can't remember if there was anything.
Yeah, I don't remember anything like that.
No, me either.
I know for many actors, I know you guys will, you know, we talk about all of the character and the moments and all that stuff, but really a show is about props and costumes. What do I have to have in my hand this time? What am I supposed to? Most of my, I have all, you know, all my notes in my script, or there's a lot of the big notes are like, change to costume number 3. It's all coordinating that stuff and running. You know, I got to be over here in my pajamas, and then I got to be over here in my work clothes, then I got to be over here. And there was a lot of that in this. Yeah. And I'm sure for Barbara especially, you got, I mean, you come on, you got to clean, you got a trash can, you get, you know, all of that stuff you had to coordinate, and it becomes, you got to get all that figured out before you can even think about acting with it. So I don't remember any mishaps with those things, but there was a lot of that stuff to think about.
I do remember one night when I'm leaving Walter's and going back home, and I'm supposed to put my wedding ring back on. It's a big deal. It's the first time I've been to Walter's. And I go to put it, I put out of my pocket, and it goes, and it falls right under the stairs of Walter's porch. Oh, crap. Like, on me getting my wedding ring back on. And I could hear Mark in the audience just like, pick it, like, find it. I think I actually got it out of my hands and knees and dug it out because I had to have it. So, that's important.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and Demetra talked about almost missing, you know, miss the Tipton scene there, which she didn't.
Just freaking barely.
But, you know, that was also one of those creative moments that you're just, wow, because Margaret was in a cabaret. She got to sing "Is That All There Is?" Peggy Lee.
Oh.
And it was,
she
did a beautiful job with it. And so that was the first, that was my introduction to the song. So I knew it. So it's in my head.
Oh, it's such a great song.
Right? And I'm reading the script, and literally Stephen Dietz writes, "Is that all there is?" And I'm like, holy shit, how do I not use it? And again, it's one of those, is it really going to work? And it just so worked.
If that's all there is.
I hear it. This is Ginger, Becky, and Walter.
Yes.
All right.
Ginger, have you met Rebecca?
Yes, I have. And how refreshing to meet someone who actually works for a living.
You'll have to forgive Ginger. She and I have always managed to say to each other exactly what's on our mind.
Is that true, Walter?
Well, I certainly think we have.
Because if that's true, I'd like to tell you this. Sheila was not well-liked. You loved her to death, I know, and she was a good mother to Kenny, but most pet people found her fakey. Always upbeat, always on the ball, always the right thing to say, the right note in the mail, the right hand towels for all the right occasions. It was too much, Walter, and after a while, nobody was buying it.
Now listen.
That woman was about as deep as a cookie sheet. In fact, we started calling her that behind her back, cookie sheet. Sweet and shallow and completely nonstick.
They're bringing the cars around.
Be careful, Walter. This one's for real.
Excellent. That's good.
No, I was, Ginger was right. Ginger was saying.
Yep.
Go get her.
No, I know. I know. But the woman's dead.
I'm dead.
Dead Schmed.
She was a cookie sheet.
I stuck.
But you're right. That was another thing that's so great about the characters in this play, is it could have been so cliche that she was all about, she wanted Walter and that was all one dimensional, mm-hmm. fighting for that. But, you know, where she evolved and what she saw. And then of course, ultimately with Steve is just great.
And that line that Kenny has, that Laura was like, you know, have you ever felt this and that and the other and blah, blah, blah. And Ginger says, no, you're the first. I mean, she learned a lot from that girl, right?
Yeah.
Can I say something about Barbara? So I think this play, the danger for Becky is that she's just going to be like the cheating bitch. And Barbara never, ever, ever allowed that. No one on the stage did. And obviously, Mark, you didn't. But I think that's like such a trap. Don't you think, Barbara?
I totally agree.
Like, you're sort of funny and flip and really just a cheating bitch instead of this really wonderful human. And that's why I love this play.
I agree.
I mean, it's such a great play. We should do it again. Are we going to do it again?
You like it. All eyes on you, Mark.
Aged, but still got it.
Demetra, you're so right. And it's about the struggle, right? And that's where Barbara just hit it out of the park. And, you know, and that was, and that's part of the beauty of theater, is I saw it evolve, right? And that's not something that you just do. You have to enjoy the journey. And I remember that production week and then going in, it's just all of a sudden realizing I could see, you know, on her face in act two, like, oh my God, what have I done? But my heart's in the right place. And everybody felt that. And then you think about all the people that came to the show and like, oh my God, I got to come back. I got to go tell three friends to come and see the show.
It was really important to make her human, but to not, like, it would have been really easy to, as Demetra said, to go into that cheating bitch thing. And that wasn't who she was. And I always, like, Mark, you and I talked about the fact that we sort of decided that Becky is in the passenger seat of her life. Like, things just happen to her. She's mm-hmm. not taking control of anything. And this kind of, Walter just walked into her life. This just sort of happened to her, and she got too far into it before she really realized what she was doing, all things considered. But I think, Chris loved her, Walter. I mean, she's a good person. It's important. And you, Mark, yeah. I remember you and I talked a lot about sort of how we wanted to play Becky and Joe's relationship, and that it was sort of important to have them still love each other. They weren't at the end of their story at all. So it was really important that even though they had their way of communicating and maybe bickering a little bit, they still really loved each other. Still, I have to call him, tell him I might be late or lost or insane. And could someone please tell me why lipstick is the first thing I find when I reach into my purse, unless what I'm trying to find in my purse is my lipstick. And then it's nowhere to be found. Like my phone. Oh, come on, Becky, find your phone. You know it's in here. Joe handed you your coat and you grabbed your purse and your keys and you left your phone at home.
You forgot your phone.
Hmm?
After all that, you forgot your phone.
Got my phone.
Who's this?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Rebecca?
You're trying to reach Becky?
It's Walter.
Walter?
Yes.
Are you the new guy?
Well.
She's on her way, probably hit traffic.
Who's this?
This is Joe.
Joe.
She left her phone here.
Oh, I see, at work.
When she gets there, tell her she left her phone.
I'll do that.
Tell her to spend the night.
Pardon me?
My car.
She deserves that, right?
Yes, I suppose so.
And the money they make on those cars.
Loan.
Oh, they loved them.
What's that?
They all loved their cars.
Radio on.
I bet they did.
Thanks for your help.
Traffic moving nice and easy.
See you, Joe.
See you, Walter.
Heaven help me. You know, I thought this was one of the most beautiful piece of writing was the monologue about Mrs. Tipton, about the car, and like how he takes you on that whole journey. Like even from the beginning when she's chasing Mrs. Tipton in the car, and then she loses her, but she keeps on driving and sees the billboards. Walter Flood, Walter Flood, Walter Flood. And just her sort of her Becky's way of actually sort of reliving the story as she's telling it, but also she's confessing a lot to the audience, and she's already had such a relationship with them that there's things that are hard for her to tell, but she has to tell them. And like Demetra's dad is like right here. He's like,
oh, my parents loved that show.
I remember your dad.
They like, loved
talking to me, right? You were talking right to me, right?
Yeah, like, did he say five? That's so perfect.
You're talking to me, right? I couldn't take my eyes off of you.
Oh, yeah. When Steve comes in, he's all clueless about, you know, the whole mega ship, and he finds out that there's, you know, Becky's gone off to the big thing and he doesn't know about it. And you think, oh, that's blown the whole story. No, it's just that Steve thinks nobody told him. He's being left out of the loop.
An affair with Amber the pharmacist.
Amber the pharmacist, right?
It's so crazy. But Mark, I don't know if you know that, but Jason and I laugh about this whole time. In every script, there's certain sections for every actor, I think, that just won't stick. I don't know what it is. But towards like three quarters of the way through, I have a phone call with Jason. I don't know. I joke that I just chose not to learn those lines. But there were so many times that Jason would just take me all the way through. I would be working away. And then I'm like, oh, shoot, it's the phone call. And it's the phone. I'm like, eh, I got nothing. I got nothing. I don't know what we're supposed to be talking about. I don't know.
Oh, my God.
Not like you had a lot to do up there on stage, right?
I don't know why. It's just one little section that would never stick. And Jason was so generous every single night of like, say what you're like, okay, she's not going to say that part. All right, I'll say it. Spoon feed you some information.
Yeah, you were in her office on that one, right? You're like, I'm in your office.
Right.
Beat up. I'm like, taking charge.
And I love the moment when, I don't know why, sitting on the couch at the end, David Berti is he's got the ring box, right? You have the ring box and you open it up, and I just have to turn towards the audience and just let every ounce of air out of my body. Like, that's it. That's the ultimate, like, look what I did. Look how much everyone's lives I screwed up. Oh, and that, and when I say to Joe, like, you're not going to let me say goodbye to him? And he lets me say, like, one half a sentence, and Walter leaves. And then
I'd
walk out, and I would want to cry every night.
Yeah.
I think we should do it again.
Yeah, definitely. I'm in.
Yeah. Socially distance this show.
Michael has to shave. Yeah. That's fine.
Oh, no, I like the beard.
It's fine. It grows back.
I'm not shaving.
So, all right, so let's go around the room, starting with Barbara. So how many, in all honesty, you're obviously not going to name names, but how many shows would you say, yep, I would love to do that again with those people?
Great question. I can say how many that I've done before that I would do again.
Right, with the same cast.
Well, obviously Noises Off because I've done it 72 times. Probably three shows, maybe max three shows. And that's a lot, I think, to want to revisit same cast. But at the same time, I feel like with this show, it was like all the planets aligned. It was perfect. Everything about it was just amazing. And it's like, I don't know, lightning in a bottle. I don't know if you can recapture it, but I'm willing to try.
It's Sweet spot. Sweet spot. Right.
Mark, sweet that's spot. Mark's thing. Look for the sweet spot, right?
Right? Right?
Right?
I mean, you're really close to the sweet spot here, right?
Right?
You sound a little bit like Scooby-Doo.
It's dueling chippies.
Right? What do you say, Chris? Plays that you do again.
So I'm sorry. Clarify once more. Scripts I would do again, or
with the same cast, right?
Same cast, actual productions. You would, if you got the call to go, do it on stage again.
Like everybody in the cast, maybe one or two.
I need to shorten my answer now. I have to.
That's a small number. It's maybe one or two. It's a small number.
Yeah, I've gone from 3 to 2 at least.
Maybe. Yeah, there's parts I would do again, but it's a small number. Yeah, two. I'm gonna say two.
What do you think, David?
You know, I can think of 5 that I would do it in a heartbeat.
Same cast. Oh, it's wonderful.
Really, really wonderful shows with wonderful cast.
That's amazing.
Good for you. Margaret, you were shaking your head. Well, how many do you have?
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Barty.
Thank you, Ms. McCarthy.
You have 5?
Yeah, probably. Well, the one that I immediately thought of because of David was doing Follies. You get to do a scene with David Berti. You want to do that scene again and again and again.
Oh, I saw that. That was great.
That was really a good show. It was fun.
Guessing it's probably more like 5 because I've been fortunate in a number of cases to have really, but it is rare. I agree. And you know, when you, the way you arrive at that is by working on it and developing it, and it just comes to life because of the whole team you have. It's a really incredible experience, and this was one of them, but it's not more than 5.
Michael?
3.
All right.
Yeah. Laura?
Solid 2. Yeah. I worked with a lot of great casts, but the whole package, let's say I've cast in scripts I would like to revisit, I pretty much enjoyed all the cast I'm a part of, but there are certain shows that I'm like, okay, I'm good. I've had my fill. There's definitely a solid 2 in my head right now.
Demetra?
I have a solid 3 and a 4th that I would love to redo just because it was so fun, but it was, you know, it was a disaster, but it was fun.
When I say I want to do it again, it's, you know, in the perfect world, I also want to enjoy the journey. Right, to kind of put a button on tonight, you know, part of the enjoyment of this play was obviously the finished product was stunning. But, you know, this was a really enjoyable journey as well. And, you know, the whole process of discovering these characters. But in all seriousness, really great journey throughout. And it was really fun to obviously discover the depth of this script.
Can I say something too? I also think that one of the reasons why this show was so great was the set and the lights and the production and the props. Like, everything was so right. The costumes, it felt so easy, you know? And that's not common.
It's almost like every person involved was working at the same speed and working towards the same goal at the same level. Everyone took their responsibilities really seriously and gave 100%.
Yeah, the whole thing got...
Everything involved about it, yeah. The music. I mean, Mark, I listened to that CD until my car broke down and got locked in there, so that was the end of that. But gorgeous. It was just beautiful. It really helped to create so much of the journey.
Yeah. And Ruth is a genius, and her set was brilliant. And then she gets Mike McTeague to come in and build that elaborate railing because she had to have that high end, right? Remember the wire railing and all those shingles?
Yeah. Oh. The lighting was brilliant. The lighting created all those different areas, or helped to enhance all those different areas.
Right. And Jason really skilled lighting with what he did with, the areas and the cues too. And Judy calling all that stuff.
How many back and forth. You know, how many cues were there?
There's a lot. I don't remember the number.
There were a lot.
You know, and there's a whole, you have to like, can I go back to my office now? stuff.
And then right.
Oh my God, Judy is the best.
She's the best.
Yep. Yeah. And then bringing up the house lights to bring audience members up on stage and dealing with all of that. Oh my God, I still can't believe we did that, right? Yeah. Crazy. So. Well, it's getting late. I know it's well past Margaret McCarthy's bedtime.
Mine too.
4 a.m. comes mighty early.
Oh. That's what are you, a farmer?
Yes. Yes, Carter.
Farmer McCarthy.
She farms children. That didn't sound right.
It's another line, never say again.
Oh my God. Wanna pet my puppy?
She's like, I get up at 4 a.m. just so I don't have to be around these other animals in my house. I just want at least an hour. Mark doesn't tell me about the next play. My children don't need help.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.
Really fun.
Thank you.
So good to see you all.
Thank you for everything. Thank you for putting this team together in the first place and letting us go on this life-changing journey.
Hear, hear.
Yes.
Everybody stay safe and don't forget to vote.
Yes, indeed.
That's right.
Right on that one. Love you all.
Yeah, love you all. Miss you. Bye, guys.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. I don't want to leave.
Chili.